Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Laura Morgan, and I'm here to welcome you into the worship of Salem Lutheran Church, where the Reverend Dr. James M. Capers is serving as our interim pastor. We are located at 4700 West 72nd Street in Indianapolis, Indiana. This is the second Sunday in the season of Lent. We are invited by Jesus into a discipleship that calls for the denial of self in order to truly follow him. For those who are here in person and to those who are viewing us by other means, thank you so much for being present for this time of worship and praise. If this is your first time with us, you should know that we are a Eucharistic community. If you are baptized into the Lord Jesus Christ and believe that he is present to forgive sins, we invite you to participate in the communion part of the service. Gather your communion elements and be prepared to remember what our Lord offers to you. If you're able, we would love to hear from you. You may locate our email on the website at salemelca.com. If you have any prayer requests or want to know how you can be a part of this ministry, please notify us. God bless, and now let us prepare for worship.
As you are able, would you please rise? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now let's take just a moment as we think about this past week. Perhaps there are some ways in which we know that we have offended God, and we want to include them in our prayers of confession. So let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us sing this opening hymn.
Glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Son, you made an instrument of shameful death to be for us the means of life. Grant us so to glory in the cross of Christ, that we may gladly suffer shame and loss for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from Genesis. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty, walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, As for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reading responsively from Psalm 22. You who fear the Lord, give praise, and you of Jacob's line, give glory. Stand in awe of the Lord, all you offspring of Israel.
For the Lord does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty, neither is the Lord's face but when they cry out, the Lord hears them.
From you comes my praise in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the sight of those who fear the Lord.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Let those who seek the Lord give praise. May your hearts live forever.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of nations shall bow before God.
For dominion belongs to the Lord,
who rules over the nations.
Indeed, all who sleep in the earth shall bow down in worship. All who go down to the dust, though they be dead, shall kneel before the Lord.
Their descendants shall serve the Lord, whom they shall proclaim to generations to come.
They shall proclaim God's deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying to them, "The Lord has acted." A reading from the letter to the Romans. The promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, "I have made you the father of many nations." In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, "So numerous shall your descendants be." He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God. But he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, "it was reckoned to him," were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise as we welcome the gospel.
Gospel according to Mark, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at the disciples, Jesus rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples, and he said to them, "If any want to be my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. The greatest challenge of life, the greatest challenge of life. Let us pray. Father God, in these moments, we first of all want to give you thanks and praise for who you are and for your desire to be all in our lives. We ask, O God, that you would give us the zeal and the strength in order to be your people in this age, to the end that your kingdom will reign. In Jesus' name we pray, and for his sake only. Amen. Now, if any of you were here last week, you know that we are in this season called Lent. And though the word Lent comes from an old English word, Lenten, meaning springtime, it has come to mean that season that does encompass spring. And I know that when we got up this morning, we wanted spring to please come. But essentially, this season of Lent has and incorporates something called the day called Ash Wednesday. And you know that Ash Wednesday begins that season of 40 days between that day and the resurrection of our Lord. You see, the 40 days of Lent help us to come face to face with our humanness in the presence of a holy God. This season of Lent, these 40 days, draws us to the need for repentance, for reconciliation, for the need for restoration, the need for deliverance and the remaking of ourselves. And last week, we began that journey. We began that journey by focusing on temptation. I guess I got to ask this question. How many of you have been tempted this past week? Tell the truth. Tell the truth. Last week we talked about temptation. Temptation are those challenges that the enemy and our flesh put before us in order to sidetrack us so that we don't follow the Lord as we need to. We said that temptation has a cycle. It starts with attraction. It moves to deception. Then there's conception. Then there's preoccupation with whatever it is. And then it moves us to subjection. And we found that if we are to have any victory periodically, it will be by the means of the one offensive weapon that the Lord has given us. When Paul likens our earthly challenges to be that of an earthly military soldier, he says that we need to put on the whole armor of God. And he describes those parts of the armor that a person in the military has. But the only offensive weapon that the Christian is given is the sword. And Paul says that it is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And that's one of the reasons why we need to read it. We need to study it. We need to memorize it. We need to pray the word. We need to share it. We need to internalize it and then use it. We found that if our leader, Jesus, was met with the challenges of temptation after his experience of being baptized at the River Jordan, then we too will be tempted after God has touched our lives by the Spirit. I did not remind you then, but let me remind you now, that in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13, the Apostle Paul says something about temptation. He says, and I quote, "No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. But God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your strength. But with the tempting, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it." So whatever temptation that we are going through or that we shall go through, God is faithful, and God will give us what we need. As I was preparing this word for today, as I was studying for you, it began to occur to me that though temptations are sure to come, there is something that is an overarching perspective that surrounds even the temptations that we experience. And this will also be a part of our Lenten journey. In our confirmation study, we have honed in on the reading and the studying of the Gospel of Mark. We have met this text in chapter 8 already. Mark, in short order, lets us in on how Jesus is discipling his disciples. He's telling parables. He's healing. He's setting people free and delivering them. And all of it has to do with how he's going to prepare his own disciples. Prior to chapter 8, he's healing, he's performing signs, he's feeding 5,000, then he feeds 4,000, he's walking on water. He sends out the 12 disciples on a street mission. But after that, he asks his disciples a question. He asked them earlier in chapter 8, "Who do people say that I am?" And they replied, well, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others say one of the prophets. But what about you? What do you say that I am? And Peter answered. He said, "You are the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God." And at that point, in Mark's gospel, Jesus warned them not to tell anybody. Now, one of the things that we have discovered is that Jesus is concerned about timing. He has a plan, and it does not include any digression into areas so that people don't veer off into some area that doesn't end up reaching the goal. And so Jesus wants them to have the full information. That's why he tells them, "Don't tell anybody now." Peter rightly answers the question, "Who is Jesus?" "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." But that is not all. And that is why Jesus warned them not to tell anybody about him, about who he is. But it is just after that where Jesus tells them something more about himself. He tells them, as we read the scripture this morning, Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering. He is to be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And as we read this morning in the scripture, we got to give it to Peter. Peter does not bust Jesus out publicly. Peter takes Jesus aside and begins to rebuke him. Peter's trying to argue with Jesus about what the Old Testament says about the Messiah. In Peter's mind, Jesus is going to be a new king. Jesus is going to put out the Judas captives. Jesus is going to fulfill a political mandate and get back their land. But that is not included. What is included is a cross. What is not included in Peter's mind is death. And the whole resurrection thing went over Peter's head. Jesus' response was, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." In other words, the kind of king, the kind of Messiah that you have in mind is not the kind of Messiah that I am. I am the Messiah who is the suffering servant. I am the kind of Messiah who dies on a cross for the sins and the healing of many. Behold, I am the Messiah who gives his life for the world. He's the kind of Messiah that has given up control of his life. And then it is not long after that that Jesus lays the big one on them. It is found in Mark chapter 8 and verse 34. If there are going to be any challenges with temptations, this is the major one. In verse 34, Jesus says, "If any want to be my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me." And if you read Luke's same account, he includes, "If any want to be my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me." I'm sure that you might be like me on your 40-day journey. I have had some experience with self-denial. I've given up some things. I have included some better habits. I've included some new ways of reading the scriptures. I've included prayer at many times during the day. And I can see some results. I may have cut short some of my eating habits. I may have spent some time giving up some personal likings. I am following the rules. Yeah, Jesus, I'm reeling in self-denial right now. But self-denial is not what Jesus calls his disciples to do. He specifically says, "If any want to be my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." It is difficult to interpret this passage in an inclusive way and the sense of what it really takes here. But originally, in the Greek text, it reads, "And he," Jesus, "summoned the crowd with his disciples and said to them, 'If anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me.'" And if you please, Jesus summoned the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone wishes to come after me, she must deny herself and take up her cross and follow me." This is a targeted word for each one who is listening to him. It is not in sort of like to the crowd, "If anyone wants to be my disciple." It's targeted. If any man, if any woman, if any girl, if any boy wants to be my disciple, you must deny yourself and then take up your cross to follow him. So folks, this is not about self-denial. It's not about going without something for a period of time, whether this is 40 days or one day. This is really about throne sitting. This is about kingdom living. It is about the one who is not only the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in general, but is about who is calling the shots in my life. It is about living not in the flesh, but living in the Spirit. I'm aware of a diagram that I have seen. It depicts a circle, which is the symbol of a person's life. And in that circle, there are many dots. Those dots are the symbols of a person's concerns and interests. Every single one of us have some things that we're concerned about daily, and we think about them often. That's what those dots are. But notice that all of these interests that we have are in disarray. They're kind of all over the place. But in that circle, there is also a chair. And that chair symbolizes the throne of a person's life. And notice that on the throne is a large S, which symbolizes the ego, that is the self. And most of the time, we are sitting on the thrones of our lives. But also notice that outside the circle, that is outside the self, there is a cross symbolizing Christ, and Christ is outside of the life. Now, this is suggesting two things. One needs to invite Christ into the circle. One also needs to invite Christ to dethrone the self, and one needs to permit Christ to sit on the throne in the life. When one has Christ sitting on the throne of the life, it is there where there is not self-denial, but denial of self. That is the major challenge for us during this season of Lent. The major challenge is to deny the self, so that Jesus Christ is sitting on the throne of our lives. And because of the fact that Jesus is concerned about our existence, about every single facet of our lives, he's also concerned about the self-denials that we are concerned with. He's concerned with the interests that have bothered us, and that's why you will notice that the interests are now in sort of like an organized fashion. They are where they need to be because they're not all over the place. And so he is concerned that you and I take up his cross by believing him, believing that he is the Messiah, that he is the Son of the living God. And then we invite him to come and sit on the throne of our lives. There's a writer of that hymn, "Lead Me to Calvary." And he says, "May I be willing, Lord, to hear daily my cross for thee. Even my cup of grief to share, thou hast borne all for me. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me. lead me to Calvary. Amen. Please let us rise and let us sing this hymn. So now let us confess the faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need.
We turn to you for meaning, Holy God. Nurture in your children the gifts of the Spirit poured out on your people, and let the mind of Christ guide the church. Give wisdom and discernment to our bishops, pastors, deacons, teachers, and leaders. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We turn to you for renewal. Save lives and ecosystems threatened by pollution and a changing climate. Cleanse the earth's waters and restore the soil. Preserve rainforests, deserts, and wildlife, that generations to come may cherish your creation. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We turn to you for justice. Uphold the worth and dignity of every person, especially any who experience hatred and rejection. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We turn to you for healing. Send compassionate helpers to any who suffer because of war and violence. Shelter unhoused people. Befriend those who are lonely. Bring hope to any in despair. And console the bereaved. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We turn to you for purpose. Remind us of your faithfulness to this congregation. Increase our trust in your guidance and keep us near the cross. Grant that our acts of service will express Christ's sacrificial love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We turn to you for peace. We honor the saints who lived in service to others, especially Elizabeth Fetty, deaconess, whom we commemorate today. Inspire us by their example until you gather us into your kingdom. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. Accompany us on our Lenten journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Share a sign of peace with one another.
Peace be with you. Worship in the sanctuary have given to the Lord as you entered. Those who are worshiping with us online may give through our website, Facebook page, or by using the U.S. mail. Now let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love. Through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated and let us prepare for the meal. Let us pray. Holy, mighty, and merciful Father, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And then again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering therefore his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen. And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Take the bread. Let us eat together. This is the body of Christ given for you. Now let us take the cup. Let us drink together. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. As you're able, would you please rise? The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which you have received, strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. And we pray that in your mercy, you would strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated for some announcements.
We have any first-time guests with us today? Okay. The annual congregational meeting is taking place today at 1 p.m. in our conference room and also on Zoom. If you have not received the info to log in on Zoom, please phone the church office. And a reminder that the written reports for the meeting may be viewed or downloaded from our website, salemelca.com. As the confirmation class will not meet today, we are asking all confirmands to attend the congregational meeting today. Saturday Zoom Bible study meets each week at 10 a.m. You may also participate from the conference room. And Sunday school takes place each Sunday morning at 10 a.m. And now we ask you to pray for this ministry, for peace throughout the world, including but not limited to Haiti, the Middle East, the Ukraine. Please also pray for those who are ill, shut in, and recovering. The Katrina Watson family, the Alexander family, the Agresti family, the Collins family, Ismay Brooms, Esther and Amet Ferrer, Adolphe Mujindo, Pete Bush, Richard Alves, Pastor James, and Veronique Capers. And that is the end of the announcements.
Thank you very much, Laura. Again, please be reminded that we are having our annual meeting. We are inviting those who have been served in mission, who are walking with us in mission, and also those who are official members. If you are a member, you have voice and vote. If you are not a member but are serving with us in mission, you do have voice. So we would ask that you be at the meeting, if not on Zoom, also in the conference room, and that will be at 1 p.m. Okay, would you please let us rise and receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us sing this final hymn. Thank you.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.